It's what you've done for me. You gave your love, he gave your life. You gave your everything.
All right, good morning. Welcome to Union United Methodist Church. And happy Mother's Day. Y'all stand. And let's give the mothers a round of applause. So where would we be without the mothers and wives? This first song actually is a good one to think about all the lessons that our mothers teach us. It's a little bit of a tongue twister, so you might have to just kind of look at the words and on the screen and watch those and think about them. And, you know, how your mother set you on the right path and kind of kept you going the right way.
Oh, I have days to lose the fight. Try my best, but just don't get it right. Where I talk the talk that I don't want, miss the moments right before my eyes. Yeah, somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have held, when I just can't see past myself. Oh, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Well, there's no denying that I've been changed, that I've been saved from who I used to be. But even at my best, I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see. Yeah, somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have held, when I just can't see past myself. Oh, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Oh, to feed the beggar on the street, love to be your hands and feet, freely give what I receive. Oh, help me be. I want to put you first above all else, love my neighbor as myself. In the moments no one sees, Lord, help me be.
One, two, three.
A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Yeah, a little more like living everything I preach. A little more like Jesus, a little less like me.
There was a drop in the ocean. Even before there was a star in the sky. Even before the world was put in motion, you were on your throne. You were on your throne and you reigned. Glory in the highest, you reigned.
bow and every tongue proclaim that Jesus reigns.
Even before your hands made the heavens,
even before
the breath of all mankind,
even before
we had to be forgiven, you were on your throne, you were on your throne, and you reign. Glory in the highest, you reign. Let creation testify by your name. Every knee will bow and every tongue proclaim that Jesus reigns. Yesterday, you are God who was and is to come. You reign in glory and the highest, you reign.
Tell them hello today. It's good to see you and welcome you here today, and it's good to welcome our online folks worshiping with us. Thank you all for being part of our worship today. Mother's Day and all the good celebrations with that, we always celebrate Epworth Children's Home. And so there's an opportunity for us to continue to support them. There's envelopes in your bulletin. And we'll see a video about that in a minute. But any gift makes a big difference. And if you're worshiping online, you can go to our website and see the announcements. But also there's a give button there. And if you click on that, you can have the option of making a gift to support our ministries to Epworth Children's Home there as well. So I hope you'll consider that. I also want to highlight the blood drive that will be next week. We don't usually think about giving blood, but then when we need blood, we want it to be there. And so if you are able to give and can take some moments when the blood mobile is here next week, sign up for a slot and let's keep that good ministry going as well. Other announcements there, Camp Kindness, other things going on. I'll let you look at those and take care of those. Some good things coming up here. May is a busy month, but that's okay. A lot of good things to attend to. We just have to plan for it. I picked up one of these stickers to remind you. If you'd like one of these stickers, there's magnetic or this kind that goes on the windshield to put on your vehicle and advertise your love of Union. Might happen like the other day when I pulled up behind a car and the red light changed and the car didn't move. And I'm sitting there thinking, man, you know, I might just blow the horn, and they had one of these stickers on the back, so I decided, nah, I'm not going to blow the horn this time. So, so save yourself from your pastor's impatience by putting one of these on the back of your car. I'm just teasing about that. Anyway, as I said, we have a ministry moment. Oh, before we go to the ministry moment, let's say a word of congratulations to Sarah Rutherford, who got her doctorate in ministry this past week from Irmo. So she's now the Reverend Dr. Sarah, and we welcome her. Our ministry moment is a video about the ministry of Epworth Children's Home.
I was 8 years old, and I was there until I was 14. You know, if you lived at the children's home for any amount of time, those guys are, you know, and many of us stay in contact today. So it was really like having another family.
When I came, what I hoped for was a safe place where I wouldn't be violated, a place where the physical abuse would stop. That was as much as I could hope for. I mean, that was, if I got that, that would be enough. Being with social workers, to know that there was gonna be food, enough food to eat at the end of the day, to know that there was gonna be safe shelter at the end of the day, those things meant everything, because that's routine stuff that we take for granted that so many people can't afford to take granted. The persons whose lives have been impacted by places like Epworth couldn't take for granted on a day-to-day basis.
What makes it different from my home setting is that I know that I'm sheltered, I am, you know, well kept, and I know that I can depend on the people there that work here. Being able to relate from all of that, I would say my faith is very strong. Now I'm very closer to God. I ask him questions, I talk to him. Sometimes it looks like I'm talking to myself. I think my faith with God is very strong.
So to get to that place where you could think about, there is a future, there might be a chance for me, that's better than you ever imagined life could be. So when somebody says, I see something more than that in you, you jump at that. When I started seeing that there were people in the world who loved me and cared about me, who didn't necessarily know everything that there was to know about me, but some of those people did know, and knowing the very worst, they still sought to love me, to reach out to me, and although they were different from me, they were still genuine about those relationships. People continued to walk with me in a journey and not necessarily expect anything in return, but then started saying, what we do expect from you in return is that you have gifts and graces that the world needs. We think you're important, you got something to contribute, and we're looking for that, and we see that in you. You start being hopeful about what the possibilities are.
I think it was only once we started getting a little older and we had a chance to kind of back up from the mirror, if you would, and reflect on, you know, what Epworth was able to do for us and provide us, you know, in one of those times that we needed that most, are we able to reflect and appreciate what they did for us and gave to us. I've just been humbled, you know, by it all, and I've just been very thankful that I've been able to give our family a different life than ours growing up. I don't know what, if I didn't have Epworth back then, I don't know that would have been possible.
Honestly, if I haven't came to Epworth, I don't know where would I have been.
Epworth is about doing more than simply rescuing people, but about seeking to make people whole.
Epworth changes lives.
It calls me and it tempts me and it wants me, but I'm not giving in. Still it taunts me and it haunts me, but it leaves me empty in the end. All the way is clear. and truth. In this running with the devil world, I'm gonna walk with you. There ain't no mountain too high or valley too low. Like a shadow, I'll follow you close wherever you go. I have everything to gain and nothing to lose. Still it tempts me, and it wants me, but I'm not giving in.
Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, Lord, we welcome you in here this morning. You've given us a beautiful day. Might be a little chilly, but each day that we receive is a blessing. And it comes from you. And Lord, this song just said a lot, spoke to my heart of allowing you in. We might give you a little, but you really want us all. So Lord, just as we prepare to worship, may we take these distractions from the outside world, just leave them there at the cross, for you. We know that you have a plan for each and every one of us. Whatever our struggles or what we're going through, you're there, you're our salvation, and you showed it through your son on that cross. Through his blood, we are saved, and Lord, just open our hearts and our minds that we may receive you and walk with you in our daily lives. In your holy name we do pray, amen.
Good morning. I love it. It's so strange. Thank y'all very much for that kind congratulations. This morning we're gonna go a little Old Testament. Also, children can go to children's church, as you may have noticed. We're gonna hear about Moses' very special birth from Exodus chapter 1 verse 8 through chapter 2 verse 10. Hear these words from Exodus. Now a new king came to power in Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "The Israelite people are now larger in number and stronger than we are. Come on, let's be smart and deal with them. Otherwise, they will only grow in number. And if war breaks out, they will join our enemies, fight against us, and escape from the land." As a result, the Egyptians put foremen of forced work gangs over the Israelites to harass them with hard work. They had to build storage cities named Pithom and Ramesses for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they grew and spread. So much so that the Egyptians started to look at the Israelites with disgust and dread. So the Egyptians enslaved the Israelites. They made their lives miserable with hard labor, making mortar and bricks, doing field work, and by forcing them to do all sorts of cruel work. The king of Egypt spoke to two Hebrew midwives named Shiphrah and Puah. When you are helping the Hebrew women give birth, and you see a baby being born, if it's a boy, kill him, but if it's a girl, you can let her live. Now the two midwives respected God, so they did not obey the Egyptian king's order. Instead, they let the baby boys live. So the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, "Why are you doing this? Why are you letting the baby boys live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because Hebrew women aren't like Egyptian women. They're much stronger and give birth before any midwives can get to them." So God treated the midwives well, and the people kept multiplying and became very strong. And because the midwives respected God, God gave them households of their own. Then Pharaoh gave an order to all his people, "Throw every baby boy born to the Hebrews in the Nile River, but you can let the girls live." Now a man from Levi's household married a Levite woman. The woman became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She saw that the baby was healthy and beautiful, so she hid him for 3 months. When she couldn't hide him any longer, she took a reed basket, sealed it up with black tar. She put the baby in the basket and set the basket among the reeds in the riverbank. The baby's older sister stood and watched nearby to see what would happen to him. The Pharaoh's daughter came down to the river to bathe while her women servants were walking beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds, and she sent one of her servants to bring it to her. When she opened it, she saw the child. The boy was crying, and she felt sorry for him. She said, "This must be one of the Hebrews' children." When the baby's sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Would you like me to go find a Hebrew woman to nurse this child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter agreed, "Yes, do that." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I'll pay you for your work." So the woman took the child and nursed it. After the child had grown up, she brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her son. She named him Moses because, she said, "I pulled him out of the water." This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Some years ago in Houston, when Hurricane Harvey hit, my uncle and aunt sent me this article about Greg and Andrea Smith, a couple who was pregnant when the hurricane hit. After years of trying and surviving the heartbreak of miscarriages, they became pregnant and spent months eagerly awaiting the birth of their baby girl. So in the heights of the floods from the hurricane, their downtown apartment became surrounded by water, and what used to be streets became rushing rivers. Now they were both doctors, but they weren't the baby delivering type of doctors. Greg was an anesthesiologist, and Andrea was a geriatrics doctor, so not specialist in delivering babies. But Greg still prepared to potentially deliver his child at home, going as far as to boil things to sterilize. But very quickly, the water was rushing to their first floor apartment and started to come through the door. Greg alerted the neighbors in the apartment complex, and they jumped into action and got her to a second floor apartment. Word spread through the apartment complex, and someone who still had cell phone service was able to communicate with their uncle, a local fireman. And unbeknownst to them, that fireman contacted a dump truck, and that dump truck was able to get close enough to the building to come and forge the roads and get Andrea. But there was still a river between them and as close as a dump truck could get. So the neighbors all jumped into action. They locked arms with each other and formed a human chain. And they helped Andrea, in labor, cross the river by protecting her and holding her as she walked across. And then they put her in the back of a dump truck, and they got her to the hospital safely, which must be one of the coolest birthing stories I have ever heard. Yeah, whatever it takes, and it takes a community. It's amazing how often we see people just do. You know what I mean? Just jump into action and just do. This woman, her story reminded me of these folks in this long reading, but it's such a great and rich piece of scripture. These people from Exodus that helped Moses be born and grow up in the face of violence and terrible odds. The Pharaoh is terrified and threatened because the Hebrews are multiplying so fast. He's scared of these outsiders that he perceives to be stronger and numerous. He's scared that they'll join the enemies of the Egyptians and overcome him as king and his people. So he comes up with a horrendous plan to reduce the number of these populous people. He approaches two midwives, Puah and Shiphrah, and instructs them with these insidious directions. When you're helping the Hebrew women give birth, if you see that they have a boy, kill him. But if it's a girl, let them live. You see, girls couldn't join or grow up to join armies or battle the Egyptians, so what did it matter if the girls lived? The midwives let them all live. And at the end of this reading, we get the name Moses pulled from the water, which is what Moses means, or Moshe. And we have all these folks, these characters in the story, and they all have names too. We get Puah and Shiphrah. Puah means splendid, from a root meaning to glitter or brilliancy. And Shiphrah means brightness, fairness, and beauty. These are perfect names for these women who help Moses come into being and grow up. All of God's children are given names. Everyone here in this room has a name. And names and identity are important to us. Shakespeare asked us, what's in a name? I think there's a lot to our names. We're going to talk a little bit more about that. I think the names of these two women, Puah and Shiphrah, which aren't names we hear a lot, should be learned in every Sunday school class. And they didn't do it alone. So we have the birth of Moses. We have Moses' mom, who isn't named here, but we later find out is Jochebed. Beautiful name, right? It means to God be the glory. And the sister that helps, we can assume, is Miriam, Moses' sister, which is commonly known to mean bitterness, but also comes from the root for rebellion, which I think works really well here. The king's daughter is bathing. She sees the baby, and she takes pity on him. She has empathy for the child. She knows that it's a Hebrew baby, but she's full of care for it. And Miriam, Moses' sister, is clever and says, oh, hey, why don't I find some random Hebrew woman to raise this child and nurse it? And she takes the baby to his actual mother, Jochebed. So Moses is raised by his mother and returned to the princess who gives him the name Moses, meaning from the river. Like I said, there's no accidental names in the Old Testament. Names are really important. All these women had names, even if they're not mentioned, and all of them are doing the work of God. Even the nameless princess, the daughter's king, gives Moses his name. Let's pretend her name is Sarah, because she's a princess. Sarah means princess in Hebrew. Just a little side note there. I've never resonated with princess, but you know, it's a good thing. Anyway, all right, these folks, they're outsiders, this group of people, the very people that the Pharaoh thinks are no threat to him, so he's going to let them live. This group of women, they are the ones who were able to work together to help and save Moses. Pharaoh doesn't see the humanity of the Hebrew people. He's overcome with fear of them, and he does everything he can to take their humanity away from them. He enslaves them. He gives them the most demoralizing and humiliating work, making sure that they know they are beneath the people of Egypt. And this sort of robbing people of their humanity, this is an egregious sin in the eyes of God, because God created us sacred. We're made in God's image. No one can strip us of that. So this is the story of Moses' birth, his origin story. And there are so many important characters, the midwives, Miriam, Jochebed, and the Pharaoh's daughter. Most of them are nobodies. Pharaoh is not threatened by women. He's going to let them live. What could they possibly do? And these women, they raise up Moses so that Moses can grow and free the Jews. These are the people that have no power. They're so non-threatening, the king will let them live. Moses needs these people because Moses comes into the world as a tiny little baby, just like our Savior. I was talking to my mom this week about this story, and she said that at the Methodist Church in Big Spring, Texas, where I was baptized, that they used to give a reed basket to babies who were born as a sign of the promise that is every child. And when my mom had a friend give birth, she also gave them a basket to remind them that every baby is full of God's promise, that it takes a whole team of people, men and women, to get Moses, or to get us to grow up just like Moses. We don't baptize babies in the Methodist Church because they have a rational assent to believing in God or because they're capable of understanding the grace that comes through the water. We baptize babies in this church and we welcome them into Christian community because we know that God works with every single human, all of us, even teeny tiny babies. Yep. And when we ask the questions of the parents and the friends and the community at baptism, we do this because while we know that we are unique and special to God and that we are christened with our own names that are given to us and unique, that we don't do anything alone. We do it with the glory of God. We do it with moms like Jacobed. We grow because the cunning and wisdom of those shining and brilliant figures like Pua and Shifra in our lives. And we overcome because of the rebellion against evil like Miriam. That's how God sees us, as unique individuals with our own personalities and names, but as part of something much bigger than ourselves. And even though we may not know the names of everyone that makes up our origin, there's a God above us that can use every single person on this earth. And when we treat people like beloved, cared-for children of God, like the folks at Epworth Children's Home do, we are doing God's work. Pharaoh didn't do it. But his daughter did. The midwives did. Moses' mother and sister did. Against such a force as the Pharaoh, a nameless Pharaoh, there's only an old promise. And the mothering that persists among the outcast, a mothering force that refuses to halt. I like this story a lot. And I've never preached on it on Mother's Day, but I think it works so well because we can be mothered by folks other than our mothers, right? Yeah, that a mother's love doesn't always come from the people that gave birth to us. This story is filled with active mother's love. Sometimes it can feel like that we can't do anything, that we're little nobodies that can do nothing or make a difference, that the weight of the world is so overwhelming and that the evil is so unrelenting that we will be swallowed up whole by it, that we're just one person. But the little things that we do add up to big results. And when we get together in community, we can make huge waves. Ordinary people refuse to let evil and despair consume their lives by fighting back with courageous gestures of kindness towards each other. Shifra and Pua continue to care for the new mothers. Moses' mother and sister refuse to give him up, and Pharaoh's own daughter takes in the Hebrew boy who floats into her arms. So what's in a name? A lot. You are a named part of your story. You are the star of your story. You have a unique identity to God. Remember that baby I talked about in the news story in the beginning? Andrea and Greg made it to the hospital because of all the folks that helped that day. And when asked by a news station, Greg said that he believed it was divine intervention. They had become especially focused on their faith, having gone through miscarriages and struggles before. And when their baby was born, when they asked about the whole event, Greg said he looked up a name and they had decided to name her Adriel, which means she belongs to God. So who are you? You little nobody. You oppressed and enslaved, you second class and third class citizens. You tiny baby. What could you possibly do? You are a part of a giant community with more love and power and grace of God than you could ever know. And sometimes to raise us up, it takes the glory of God, a rebel, brilliance, beauty, and maybe even a princess. But God is working with you and through you. And that tiny baby who got lots of help to survive would one great day grow up to part the sea and free God's people. That's pretty great. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor.
Our time together, I need to share an announcement with the congregation. On behalf of the SPRC, we have a committee, Staff Parish Relations Committee, that deals with all the employed people, myself and everybody else in the church. And this one concerns Sarah. Sarah will be leaving us at the end of June. Yes, let me give you the background. Sarah is married to John Hoyne. He is a United Methodist minister, and he's presently serving Platte Springs United Methodist Church. And John has applied to go back to school and get a master's in health administration. Emory offered him a nice scholarship to come and do that there. So it was going to be a long commute for Sarah to drive back and forth from Atlanta to here every day. So she's going to go with her husband back to Atlanta as he leaves the ministry for a while in the pulpit and goes and gets a new degree. So we've just gotten really to know Sarah in this year and just finding her place here and her ministry and now a new change. That happens in life, doesn't it? And it happens to us. And so we're sad about her departure, but we're going to pray that everything falls in place for her and John as they take on a new chapter of life together. On the last Sunday of June, June 26, I believe, during the Sunday school hour, there will be a reception, and John will have already left Platte Springs, so that he will be here as well. And we hope we can send them off in fine fashion at the end of June. Be in prayer for our Staff Parish Relations Committee. We're looking now to see, with the help of the Bishop and Cabinet, if we might find somebody to fill that position for the coming year. So if any of you would like to volunteer, just let me know after the service, okay? All right. Well, we have things to pray about, and I wanted you to be aware of what was going on with your pastoral leadership. Let's join together in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and the time to worship you together. And thank you for the word that is shared in music and in proclamation. And God, we thank you for our own mothers, those who gave us life and nurtured us, and for sometimes those wonderful warm feelings, and other times a mother could not be all that she would have liked to have been. But yet, Lord, your grace has been shown to us. So thank you, as Sarah reminded us, for all those who took on the act and the responsibility of mothering us and caring for us and nurturing us. And we just pause to give you praise for that. I pray, Lord, this morning for those who are new moms and young moms and are growing into a new role. Bless them, Lord. That's such an exciting but such a challenging time of life. And so give them grace for all that goes on in those lives. Heavenly Father, thank you for Epworth and the mothering that takes place there and other institutions like that. May they continue this wondrous work of providing safe homes and nurturing for those who really need that. Heavenly Father, we don't just pray about that, but we pray about the changes that are taking place here. And so, Lord, we ask that you help us to realize that you go before us. I'm not going to ask you to go before us because you already do that. But help us to realize that and to trust you when changes occur. And church life and in our personal life, help us to realize that you have gone ahead of us and we'll just follow you. And thank you for that, Lord. I pray for those who are carrying heavy burdens today, whatever they may be. It might be because of a relationship gone sour or financial problems or something happening at work or even a sickness. Lord, whatever is weighing upon the hearts that are here today, come alongside and bring your grace and strength and your wisdom and allow your spirit to let us know that you will not desert us, but that you will provide. Thank you, Father, for doing that. We pray for our world and for all the conflicts and things that have just gone so wrong in our world. We ask, Lord, that you would be the peace in the midst of this, and that you would help us to see not just the bad things the news throws in our face, but also the wonderful things that are always there. We love you, Father, and we want to serve you and follow you and let others see that your grace is important to us. So we've now prayed together as your Son has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Sarah, would you come? And folks, would you stand? And we'll let Sarah give us a benediction.
Friends, we live in a hurting world that is in need of a lot of mothering. Yes? Yes. And the mother's love is not weak, is it? Mother's love is powerful. Go forth into this hurting world and love folks with the love that God has showed us how to give, that strong, convicting love of a mother. Happy Mother's Day. Go forth and be blessed.